Hey, this is Lee Nevis, host of See Jane Sell. Thanks for listening to the following podcast on Public House Media.
Hi, this is Emily.
This is Lindsay.
And this is Elizabeth,
co-hosts of Beauties and Headcanons here on Public House Media. Thanks for listening to the following broadcast on Public House Media.
Once you are done with this episode, we hope you'll come check out our show, Beauties and Headcanons, where we talk nerdy to you about fandoms, fan fiction, and all pop culture for nerds that you can think of. A new show comes out every Friday.
Don't forget to subscribe on iTunes so you never miss an episode of Beauties and Headcanons. Thanks again for checking out the following broadcast on Public House Media.
Be forward, a big week to talk about so many different things, including a very untimely 1-0 loss to the Richmond Kickers. Welcome inside the show. I'm Baxter Colburn, your host. We are just a second to last episode away from Forward Madison's own team podcast being done for the season. As we mentioned a couple weeks ago, we are going off the air on August 21st. For those that have their calendars handy, that is next Wednesday, unfortunately. So one episode left after today. If you have thoughts, ideas, things you want us to do for the final episode, I'd love to hear about it. Social media is the best way to get in touch with us as a show, at Baxter Colburn, at Let Me Be Forward on Twitter. And if you want to tweet at my co-host, Maddie, she is at Maddie Kumm, M-A-D-D-I-E. The show is on social media, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and on your favorite podcasting platform. We are presented by Public House Media. Find more info about them by going to publichousemedia.org. How you feeling? How you doing after that very surprising, in my opinion, 1-0 loss to the Richmond Kickers? Still work to be done. Greenville's coming to town soon, but first we have to go to Greenville to get some work done there on the road. Three of the four matches, as we mentioned, in the month of August are at home, but we got to go to Greenville and get a much-needed victory to get back into the playoff race. With all that being said, let's take a look at some news and notes from around the soccer world. The big thing that jumps out to me just right out of the gate, and I don't know if you've heard this or not with the transfer news that's going on, but Barcelona and PSG are trying to work out a Neymar deal right now. And if you've heard the most recent update, at least at the time of this recording, it's kind of absurd. Barcelona is willing to trade Ivan Rakitic, Philip Coutinho, and 100 million euros for Neymar to get Neymar back to Barcelona. They would send those two players and 100 million euro over to PSG. That seems absolutely absurd to me. I've never been one that thought that Neymar was worth as much as he apparently is in the eyes of some of pundits and even obviously the organizations. But two players that are very talented, I don't think I would do that deal. I don't. I really don't. I mean, let me rephrase that. I would not do, if I'm Barcelona, I think that's a foolish move. If I'm PSG, 100% take that deal. You get two high-quality players. Rakitic's getting a little bit old, but Coutinho's really young and talented. And 100 million euro, yeah, you can go out and buy another great, very talented player with that kind of cash. Barcelona is just scraping to get Neymar back to try to continue to build relevancy, as they know that the Messi era is getting to the end. So I wouldn't be surprised if this deal does actually happen. It just seems really foolish, in my personal opinion, that it would take place at this point. Other big things that have taken place, let's go to the scores from this last week of USL League 1. Greenville beats Toronto 3-1. Richmond beats Forward Madison 1-0. Chattanooga with a big 2-1 upset over Tormenta. North Texas and FC Tucson draw 1-1. That just boggles my mind, if I'm being 100% honest with you. When you look at the rest of the way that things are right now, it's funny to me that those games took place the way they did. But I'm excited for these next slate of games. On Friday, Orlando and Lansing. Maybe an upset alert for Orlando winning that game. Chattanooga and North Texas. North Texas, we need you to win this game for forward Madison's sake. Greenville and Madison, of course. Richmond and Toronto. Richmond should we need to win needs them to win that game. Tormenta and Tucson. Tucson, you need to get another victory for us, please. And then next week on our final episode, Tormenta and Chattanooga play. I guess Tormenta could win that game. So keep an eye, though, on the two games to watch, Chattanooga and North Texas and Tormenta and Tucson. You need North Texas to win that game, and you need Tucson to win that game as well. Those are some of the quick news and notes from around the soccer world. The Premier League, obviously, is back and rolling. Man City getting a big 5-0 victory over West Ham United. It's great to see what you can do when you have unlimited funds and an insanely talented manager at your disposal as well. But speaking of insanely talented folks, let's go to Madeline Kumm. She is incredibly talented and smart when it comes to the soccer world, but also just in the media industry as a whole. She has our very first interview of the show this week. She is sitting down with Omar Palacios, the founder of La Barra 608, and a key member of The Flock as well. So with that being said, Omar and Maddie, take it away, guys.
Let's just start out by talking about why you wanted to get involved with Ford Madison FC and why you started La Barra 608.
I started it mostly so that there was a larger Latino community involvement in the team. It started off small, you know. It was my buddy and my brother and I were the co-founders, and we obviously have been watching soccer for such a long time. We had practically grew up with it, and we just thought that we could try to bring the flair of, you know, some of the Latin American countries, some of their flair of soccer into the Madison community.
Cool, and talk about why that's so important. I had April on last week, and she talked about minorities. She has Mingo ladies, and she's involved in a few different supporter groups as well. So can you talk about why it's so important for Ford Madison to have that representation?
I think for Ford Madison and Madison as a city, I think it's really important because there's so many communities here. There's so much involvement. You know, so it's nice to have something that somebody may feel comfortable with, like they kind of feel like a reference to or something. So we just wanted to make sure anybody and everybody could come to a game and feel like they were part of the team already or part of the flock, you know, because obviously we're all part of the flock already. Mm-hmm. So that way they all felt like they were already part of it, and it didn't feel strange to them coming to a Ford Madison game.
So this is obviously the inaugural season. This is something that I'm curious about. We have different supporter groups. We have yours. We have Mingolays. We have Featherstone. We have quite a different... Do you think that there's any maybe gaps or room for even more supporter groups that haven't been touched on yet? I'm just looking forward for next season.
Well, there's definitely room for a lot more supporter groups. I know there's always people asking or sending us messages online about how they can get involved in one way or another, or like if they're, you know, we're getting into the months where some of the students are coming in, you know, so there may be some students who may want to form their own group or may want to get involved with one of our groups. You know, we don't know exactly how far this whole supporter group may go, but we want it to go far, and we want anybody and everybody to feel welcomed into any of our groups, or if they wanted to form their own group, they can go ahead, and we'd obviously be more than happy to, you know, help them out with anything they need.
That would be really cool to have like a student-run supporter group. I didn't even think about that. Again, back to the inaugural season situation, can you talk about how La Barra 608 has kind of grown and what maybe your initial hopes for it were and what it evolved into?
My initial hopes actually weren't that high. It was just something, like I said, my brother and my buddy and I wanted to start, And now that, you know, we were more than halfway through the season, we've seen a lot more Latino community members, like, involved. You know, you've probably seen the picture of the big flamingo that our buddy Leo has made. There's the luchadores who are always out there in their masks, you know. Some of our other friends end up going out there to some of the games every once in a while where they can. Like this last Saturday, one of our good buddies from high school actually showed up. We didn't know he was coming. He came and sat with us next. We were all drumming that night, so it was pretty awesome to see a lot of the Latino community members out there, especially with the Leones Negros game. You saw quite a bit of Latino population at the game.
Wow. And then what do you want to see more, you know, going forward? What do you want more of? What are your plans maybe for the next seasons to come? You know, maybe besides growth, do you have anything special that you're looking forward to, or do you really just want to keep increasing the brand and just getting more and more people involved?
I think we have a great starting point with Levadar 608. Yes, obviously we do want to grow a little bit more, get more involved into the community, get involved with a lot of the Latino councils or anything that may help us include the community in with the soccer community too. So we do want to branch out into different aspects and just try to help out Madison overall, be more welcoming into this whole soccer aspect.
And final thoughts here. Where can people reach you? How can they get a hold of you if they want to join? You know, like social media handles, or what's the easiest way for people to get in contact with you if they want to join La Barra?
Our easiest way are any of our social medias, which would be Twitter, Instagram, or Facebook. They are all at La Barra 608. Obviously, you guys can send us a message at any time. You can go to the flock too. We work with them. We're part of the flock. So any of those ways is a great way to reach out to us.
And very last question, what's the tip that you would give to somebody coming to their first game with interest in joining a supporter group?
A good tip? Bring energy, I think. We are loud. Pride ourselves in being a very vocal supporter group, obviously, because we are the best supporter group in the whole league. So just be loud out there with us. Have fun. You know, any questions, reach out to us. We're always out there.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much for sitting down with me for this episode. I really appreciate it.
Time now for our weekly conversation with forward Madison head coach Daryl Shore. Following a 1-0 loss to the Richmond Kickers, a lot to talk about and a lot to dive into. But first and foremost, welcome back to the show, Coach Shore. Good to see you again.
Likewise, Baxter. Glad to be on as always.
Good to have you back on, Coach. So let's look a little bit at what took place this last week. There was some good spurts from the offense, and ultimately the way the game sometimes happens in any soccer game, the counterattack ending up being the way that forward Madison goes down in this 1-0 loss. But definitely some good bright spots throughout the match, but I'd love to hear from your perspective, obviously, what you saw, and ultimately, of course, not the result you wanted, especially with the playoffs around the corner, but give me your perspective of this 1-0 loss.
Yeah, I mean, it's a game where the first 18 minutes of the game were obviously in our favor. And so, you know, we create a couple of what we call half chances, but aren't really quite good enough in the attacking third. And then they get the chance off of our corner kick, and from there, till the rest of the half, it kind of just was one of those where they weren't really breaking us down. We never really felt threatened other than that. But we also didn't do a great job of penetrating and making enough plays to really get any good quality chances, with the exception of Oliver's chance that hits the post in the, you know, later part of the first half. So you get in at halftime, you're 0-0, you feel like, okay, it's the goal was going to come. We felt like we were doing some things good. We discussed, at halftime, a couple of different ways to try and break them down because they were making it tough putting 11 guys behind the ball and just looking to counterattack. And really felt like we came out in the first 5 minutes. We again created two what you call half chances. And then the one that bites us in the rear end is the counterattack where we don't make a good play, and then they are, they take advantage of an opportunistic bounce and find a goal. And from there, it was going to be a tough day for us trying to find the equalizer with the way they were playing. So it's not a result that we were anticipating. It's not a result that we're happy with. But at the same time, at the end of the day, being honest, as obviously we always are, mm-hmm. We weren't quite good enough on the day, and probably didn't deserve to lose, but at the same time didn't deserve to win the game. So credit to Richmond. They had a game plan. They came in. They were good at it. And to be fair, they've won three games in a row now, so they're on a little bit of a roll, kind of like we were.
Absolutely, yeah, and that's definitely one thing to, as you mentioned, kind of take your hat off to Richmond now, a three-game win streak for them, and it's been interesting to watch how the teams in this league have kind of ebbed and flowed. We'll talk about Greenville in a minute, obviously, but with them winning four of their last five. I do want to ask defensively, because in the starting 11, at least from what I saw, we saw Toyama back on the defensive side. What was the motivation to go that route with him?
We felt like we could get after them a little bit with our outside backs and get guys into the attack. And so we just thought that having Giro at left back would give us a little bit better option getting forward. And obviously he's a natural left-footed player. He's played left back for us as well as left wing. And so we just thought that was, probably the way to go. Usually when Carter is not with us, Christian always plays on the right. So we just made the decision to go with Giro, thinking that we would get a little bit more out of him going forward. And to be fair, we did. We got a little bit of it going forward. We just missed the final product in the final third.
Has there been a player or two that you've seen play several positions this season that you've just been impressed with them, through and through? Not that obviously you're not impressed with your players, but a guy like Eric Leonard, who we've seen step into multiple positions, and you mentioned Hero, and I know a couple other guys come to mind, but have there been a couple for you that have just been nice to kind of say, oh, they're kind of our Swiss Army knife players?
Yeah, I mean, you mentioned two of them with Eric and with Giro, and we kind of talked about a little bit today. Paolo has been doing such a great job on the left side, not just with his attacking presence, but helping us now with his defending and the way he's tracking back and helping us. But, also now when we've played him up top as a nine, obviously when we went on the Open Cup run, he played up there a couple times for us and did well with that. We've got, three or four guys that are versatile and can play a couple of different positions. And when you have a roster like we do that maybe isn't as deep as other teams in our league, you've got to have, three, four, five players that can play multiple positions. And that's what we have. And, it's not, defensively, again, not our issues. We gave up two shots on goal and gave up a goal. We had 11 shots, but none on goal. So mm-hmm. Usually when we lose games, it's usually because our attacking group is creating a lot of chances, but for whatever reason on the given night, those chances just aren't either getting on frame or getting in the goal. So again, we haven't lost a goal other than Dallas away, North Texas away. That's the only game we've lost by two goals. So It's not like we're going into games and not doing well defensively. We're doing well. We have three losses at home. They're all 1-0 losses. So it's not great. It's not what we want to be doing. But at the same time, we don't feel like there's a game where we've just not been in it from start to finish.
Absolutely. And now you mentioned the rate of goals scored, but also from the defensive side. You get another big test as you go to Greenville. They have won 4 of their last 5 games, scoring 10-plus goals in those last 5 games. They've played an exciting brand of soccer, and I think they've kind of surprised some folks that haven't been following them too close, myself included, you know, with this big run over some pretty quality opponents. It's been a while since you've seen Greenville, obviously, in person. Give me your scouting report. How do you plan to break down what appears to be a pretty high-flying offense? But also, defensively, they haven't allowed a lot of goals.
Yeah, I mean, listen, they've got Jake Keegan, who's a leading goal scorer in our league, or tied for the league. So you've got a... You've always got to be aware of where he is on the field, and you've got to now make sure that you're limiting, not just limiting his chances, but limiting his touches on the ball. And then, you know, they've got some good attacking midfielder players, and right now they're playing with a lot of confidence, and so now they're the team that's been in good form and on a good run. And whenever you have a 10-team league, this is how that works. You're going to have one or two teams that catch a little run and win 3 or 4 games and get on a good roll, which we did a couple weeks ago. So now we've got to now just make it hard for them when they have the ball and just make it to where they don't get a lot of chances. And, again, it's two good defensive teams that are going to play. You know, they play out of a 4-4-2, so we've got to figure out how we're going to break them down and what areas of the field we're going to attack. They've got a good defensive group. Tyler Pollock's a good attacking left back. They've got 2 quality center backs, and then they have a goalkeeper who does very well for them, and they do. They limit the number of chances. But at the same time, I don't think they've played a team that attacks quite the way we do. And so now it's a game where they sit 1 point in front of us, and we're both chasing that 4 spot that they're 1 point behind and we're 2 points behind. So I do think you'll see 2 teams that play a good style of soccer and are going to get after each other, but also are going to be pretty smart in how we approach the game, both offensively and defensively.
When you look at the top 4 standings right now, you've got, you know, North Texas and Lansing up there. Chattanooga just recently kind of catapulted into the top 4. Is there one of those 4 teams that surprise you at all? I mean, I don't know if Lansing is the surprise team, but obviously you would know better than I. But do one of the 4 current top 4 teams surprise you with the fact that they are in a said playoff position?
Not really. I mean, when you have a 10-team league, there's a lot of parity. And so...
Right.
You know, you take Orlando out of it, but even a team like Orlando, they can beat any of these teams, you know, on any Saturday,
yeah,
or Friday or Sunday, whenever we play these games. But it's one of those things where, you know, you try and put a point total on it and say, okay, this is how many points we need. But at the same time, that keeps changing because you have a team like North Texas who was running away with it, and now they've come back to the pack. And
mm-hmm.
So you have a team like Tormenta that was up there, and now they're starting to bleed some points. So we still have a number in mind, and we feel like if we get to that number, we're going to have a good chance to be in the top 4. But there's really not – there's a lot of parity in this league. So surprise is probably not, you know, a word that you would use as to the teams that are in the top 4. And the thing is, like we just found out, it can change week to week because we went from being in 8th place to then being in 4th place to now being in 6th place. But we're the 6th place team that's 7 points out of 1st place, 5 points out of 2nd place with 2 games in hand, 3 points out of 3rd place, 2 points out of 4th place, and then a point out of 5th place. So it's really one of those where if we go to Greenville and get a result and get a win, and Tormenta and Chattanooga don't get results, then we're in 3rd place and everybody's like, whoa, they're back in it. So it's really going to come down to the last 2 weeks.
Mm-hmm. And that's, I think, what makes a lot of people excited to see how it's all going to shake down, and certainly makes for an exciting time for the fans and, of course, from your perspective, the coaching and players as well. Coach, we're excited to see what it all shakes down for you with against Greenville and then back at home for 2 more matches against Richmond and Greenville as well. Always a pleasure, and we appreciate the time, sir.
All right, Baxter. Thanks again for having me.
This week on Let Me Be Forward, we have the opportunity to interview two different forward Madison players. This week, it is the first time that we get to have him on the show. He wears the jersey number 17, and we've seen him all throughout the season. He even scored the very first goal ever in forward Madison history, and is number 17, Zaire Bartley, and he's on the show with us this week. Good evening, Zaire. Welcome to the show.
Good evening.
Good to have you on the show, man. Thanks for taking some time. I'm excited to chat with you because I feel like it's been a long time coming. We've talked to so many different players on the team, and now we get the chance to kind of hear a little bit about your story and hear a little bit about what got you to this point. But I mentioned it in the introduction. You are the first person to ever score a goal for Forward Madison in their existence. That's kind of a cool little piece of history that you get to always take with you.
Yeah, that is. That is. You know, it's good, and it was very exciting. Very exciting.
So, tell me a little bit about your story, because you're from New York. You're 21 years old. You're one of the youngest players on the roster. How do you find yourself going through the Jamaican national youth teams to a team in the Czech Republic to Madison, Wisconsin?
I never thought last year I would have been here. But since I've been here, I've loved it. I have a great opportunity knowing Don Smart. So it's just taking it step by step, trying to move up the table, you know?
Absolutely, yeah. And I know that, as you mentioned, yeah, the relationship with Don Smart has been a big part of your success and obviously a big catalyst to getting you to Madison as well. I'm curious because one of the big stories that I feel like is not talked about enough about you is your eligibility for Jamaica's national team and the fact that you've also played for their U-17 team as well. I feel like any time you get to represent your country on an international stage, that has to be a special feeling. I want to hear a little bit about your time with the youth national team.
Yeah, it was a great experience. You know, it was when I got called up the first time, you know, I was so excited because I was able to play for my dad's country. So that was a big thing for me and my family, and it was very good, you know. It was a good time. I enjoyed it, and I love playing with national team, playing with players from a country or island that's some of the best players in that part of town.
Absolutely, and I think we've seen that even just for those that follow CONCACAF as well. You know, Jamaica is a team that continues to grow over the last couple of seasons, and they're a lot of fun to watch. I always find myself cheering for Jamaica outside of cheering for, you know, the United States as well, but just a lot of fun, creative play. How do you feel like playing through the youth national team has brought you the skills that have now led you to being a good role player here for Forward Madison?
It's good because you're playing with like top players from wherever country you're playing for, and like you learn. As a young player, you know, you learn from other players, you know, so it was a good experience. And also I learned stuff from great coaches and great players that I've been playing with.
And I think ultimately that experience is, of course, what so many players love to take, especially early on in their career. You lean on those veterans, you lean on the experience of those guys that have come before you and pave that way so that way you can obviously forge your own destiny but also continue to learn. When you look at what you've done with Madison so far, you've got the chance to be a part of several games so far this season, coming off the back of a tough 1-0 loss to Richmond. I'm curious to get your perspective just from what you've seen. You referenced Don Smart earlier. His offensive contributions to the team, of course, have been a huge part to why the team has done so well. But where do you feel that you fit into this mold? When Daryl Shore says, hey, I need you to step in, what are usually his instructions to you? We know you can play on the wing. We know you're creative. But typically, what are your marching instructions when you are about to step on the field?
My instructions is usually to bring the energy, you know? If the team don't have that energy, usually I'm the sub to bring in that energy and make a difference, you know, make a change.
Absolutely. And I think being able to inject that offense, especially that energy late in a match sometimes coming on as a late substitute can make a big difference. You talk about energy and you talk about the different things that you've done in your career, and it's been a short career, as you mentioned, but you played in the Czech Republic. What is the soccer culture like going from the Czech Republic over to Madison?
Czech Republic, of course, it's in Europe, so it's a big, big difference coming back to United States. You know, they're a little bit more advanced technically wise, but Madison here is, I feel like we could compete with any team out there.
And I think that's an interesting point, too, because you look at the way that certain clubs, especially sometimes what some might say the semi-pro clubs or even the lower-level professional clubs, it's like, I don't think they could really do well against higher level. But the class that we've seen from Forward Madison, as you mentioned, has been very just dynamic. I mean, you talk about some of the other, you know, talented players on this team, even the goalkeeping, the offensive side of the ball, which you're in as well. This team can really run with anybody. And
yeah,
with the season getting closer to winding down, you've got some big matches against Greenville and Richmond obviously coming up. What is your focus personally as a player to prepare for the last couple of games, regardless of how big or small your role might be?
My goal is just to show everybody what I can do and help the team as much as possible. My goal really is to get to playoffs. And that's it for right now. We have one goal so far, is to get to playoffs and then we move on from there.
Absolutely. And just a couple of points out of the playoffs right now, especially with the loss to Richmond, but Greenville on the road this coming week and then back again for two more games at home against Greenville and Richmond, respectively. Before I let you go, I have to ask from the perspective of the culture of living in Madison. You're a young guy. You've got a lot going for you. Obviously, you're playing with some great players as well. But when you're not on the field, when you've got some off time, what do you do in Madison? Do you have some local spots you like to hit up with your teammates or just other friends that you've made?
I haven't really been out to spots like that. Usually, just chilling, like relaxing or working out on my own, you know?
Sure.
But I also like to, I notice I do a lot of running downtown more times by the water. And I usually just listen to music and talk around with teammates.
Absolutely. You talk, yeah, I got to ask you what's on the warm-up playlist for you.
You know, hip-hop, a little bit of rap, or some reggae.
There you go. I love that. Awesome. Well, hey, Zaire, I appreciate the time and for jumping on the show this week, and we are excited to see just how your role continues to develop, but also the fact that your career still has so many more stories yet to be written as well, and we look to hopefully seeing you for Jamaica's national team again in the future and, of course, as a continued key player for Forward Madison. So thank you for the time tonight. I appreciate it.
All right. Thank you. No problem. Welcome to my house. Baby, take control
now. We had the opportunity to talk to Zaire Bartley earlier in the program, and now we get to move to a man that has spent some time in between the sticks for Forward Madison and for Minnesota United this season. He has been one of the five lone players from the Loons and has been an integral part of Forward Madison's playoff run. It is Dayne St. Clair, and he joins us on the show. Dayne, good day to you, sir. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you for having me. Thank you.
Absolutely, Dayne. So you've had a pretty unique story so far this season compared to a lot of the guys on Forward Madison. You've been splitting your time between Minnesota and Wisconsin. First of all, are you exhausted from all the traveling back and forth between the Twin Cities and Madison?
I wouldn't say exhausted. I'm kind of used to it now, and I think either way you look at it, whether you're playing away games or things like that, you're just used to traveling within this business. So I feel like I'm adjusted to it.
Absolutely, and I think you've proven that time and time again. It's pretty fascinating to me the fact that this is a pretty awesome opportunity for you, because sometimes when a player goes on loan, one of the biggest complaints we hear is the atmosphere is just not the same. But I feel like you're kind of spoiled when you're home. You've got the Wonderwall behind you. If you're in Madison, you've got the flock. And how much do you feed off of that as a goalkeeper? Do you just kind of block it all out when you're in the goal?
No, for sure. I mean, definitely playing with two big groups of fans and such supporters plays a big role. I think you kind of, you feel that extra boost, and that atmosphere like you're talking about is so, like, you want to work for the fans and for the rest of the guys on the team. And it kind of is like that 12th man. You kind of can look at other teams sometimes and you see like they may not be adjusted to it, and it plays a role in their mind. But I think for me and my personality, I definitely feed off of it.
Absolutely, and I think that is ultimately the biggest part about it. Is as a fan base, you want to be able to, as you mentioned, go to that 12th man. Seattle does that a really good job, both in the NFL, also in just in MLS as well. And it's great to see that Minnesota and so many other teams, especially Forward Madison, kind of jumping onto that as well. I have to ask, the best part about, I think, being on Ford Madison, of course, is the fans, but it's also the unique opportunity of being a part of history as well. And you were on the very first Ford Madison team that played the very first USL League One game. You were the starting goalkeeper day one. Was that a surreal experience? Was it just kind of, hey, just got to do my job? What was that first part when you realized, hey, this, I'm actually the very first time ever in the history books, my name's going to be listed as the first starting goalie for the team?
I think it didn't really, I mean, you kind of knew about it before, but I just tried to focus on the game and the task at hand. I think kind of it hit me a little bit after, but I think in the moment I just wanted to approach the game, try our best to get 3 points. Unfortunately, we didn't. But I think just try to approach the game in the right manner, and then I think kind of after the game is more so when it hit me.
Absolutely. Talk about those moments, especially of hitting you. You, before your career officially got started, the catalyst to it was winning the 2018 National Championship. Talk about that experience, winning the University of Maryland. You know, you didn't allow a goal in the final 500 minutes of the season. That's pretty darn impressive in my book, and I think anybody's book, really. But being a national champion, especially in soccer, is not an easy feat. Give me your reaction to that, especially playing such a vital role during those last final moments.
Yeah, it was such a surreal moment. I think it's kind of one of those things that I didn't really set in until a few days after. And I think kind of you just, especially because no one really had us winning either. Like I think the team knew that we were capable of doing it and we felt confident that we could. But from an outsider's perspective, we kind of had an up and down season with a very tough schedule. But I think kind of the best part about winning it was the fact that no one expected us to be there. But it was just such a surreal moment. It's really hard to describe because there were just so many emotions within the whole stretch, I think.
Absolutely, and I think you hear that sometimes as well. Sometimes players, they have to go through years of, you know, just onward from that to finally be able to process what it's like to win, you know, a Super Bowl, an NBA championship, a national championship, to then actually reflect, you know, 10, 12 years later, be like, oh my gosh, like I've just now finally processed those feelings because it was such an awesome experience. And an even bigger part of it, I feel like, outside of winning a national championship, is the emotions that you went through on draft day. Selected 7th overall by Minnesota United in the 2019 MLS Super Draft. We hear always about the stories, you know, from different sports, and I think soccer in America is unique because there is the draft. You don't have that in European soccer or any other, you know, form of soccer worldwide, but hearing your name called 7th overall is a huge feat.
Yeah, for sure. I think it was kind of another one of those moments where, like, I think that's probably the most nervous I've ever been in my life because you don't know where you're going to go, whether a trade happens or you think a team might pick you and they end up picking someone else or you drop down the boards. So I think going into it was probably the most nervous I've ever been in my life, but I think I was very happy that Minnesota selected me and in the spot which they did, and I think I'm grateful for them, and I think with the opportunity that's come with being able to get some minutes with Madison as well.
How much of an indication did you have that Minnesota was going to take you at 7? Had you had previous discussions from the player combine, or did you have another team that you thought might steal you?
I had discussions. I had an interview with them, but I also had an interview with numerous other teams. So, I mean, you're never really sure what's going to happen, especially with you see the amount of trades that happen on on drafts as well. Like, especially, you never really know. I mean, you can kind of hope for certain things, but I think you never really know until you hear a name called.
Absolutely, and I think that's you hit the nail on the head. There's some teams and some players you hear are just like, yep, that's our guy, we always knew it, and then other times you're like, I have no idea, I just want to hear my name called, I don't care who it is. And of course, some players are like, oh, it'd be great to play here or play there, but I think even just from an outsider's perspective, I think you pretty much lucked out with the opportunity of playing for Minnesota just because it's a great culture, it's great players to learn from, good coaching staff, but then you mentioned it, also that opportunity to have a good secondary culture about being a part of Madison. When you look at the group of guys that you're working with right now, you're very much surrounded by good coaching but also good teammates at the goalkeeper position. I'm curious to get your perspective about who you have in Minnesota, but also you've got a pretty fun group of guys that we've gotten to know on the show at least this year with Brian and Ryan and some of the other guys that you've been dealing with as well. So talk a little bit about what it's like to work between those two groups of keepers.
Yeah, I think in Minnesota, I mean, Obviously, you have Vito, who's very experienced, but also Bobby's experience within the league as well. So I think kind of just combining those two and being able to feed off them every day when I'm training in Minnesota is good for my development, and they're both really nice guys. I think kind of just the being able, as a young player in my position, being able to learn from two veteran guys and have those guys ahead of me, being able to learn off them in training when I'm training there is very good for my development. And then I think also the same too, when I come down to Madison, of course, the guys are a little bit older than me there as well. But I think kind of just combining and collaborating with everyone, especially we all have our own different styles. So I think kind of taking bits and pieces from everyone's game and seeing how I can apply it to my game and improve my game.
So we've joked with Ryan Coulter before. Is he ever actually at practice, or is he always traveling with his wife and golfing?
He does train, but I feel like he does love a nice golf day if we get out of training early.
He is, I swear.
From the times I've been there, at least.
Oh, my gosh. I follow him on Instagram. I'm like, dude, are you ever at practice? Like, he's always posting stuff out running around. I'm like, okay. I'm like, I just see you three guys standing around being like, has anybody seen Ryan? I don't know where he is. But it's good to know that you do have such a good group of guys down there. But and we kid with Ryan. He's a good friend of the show, but we still like to have fun with him, of course. But before we let you go, Dana, I've got to get your perspective. A big push these last couple of games, of course, the 1-0 loss to Richmond, not exactly what I think anybody had in the cards. But and especially when you're sharing time with Ryan and Brian as well. Where has the discussions been from Coach Shore's perspective, saying, hey, this is kind of how we'd like to use you going down the stretch? Will we see you against Greenville, or where have you been kind of in communication with that so far?
In my situation, it's more of a play in the last minute. Of course, between Madison and Minnesota, they have to decide what they think's best for me. So I kind of leave that up for the coaching staff and the technical department to deal with that. And then when I get my opportunity to play, I of course put everything I have into it. But in terms of moving forward, I just kind of let them deal with it, let them transfer the message to me. And then when my name's called, I put my all in to try and get the 3 points and a clean sheet.
Absolutely. And I think we've seen that more than once. Last question before we let you go, some of your top moments or top saves from the season so far, just moments you look back, you're like, yeah, I made that save, or how in the heck did I do that? Or just cool experiences that you've been a part of so far.
I think from the Minnesota standpoint, playing against Hertha Berlin, my first game at Allianz, I think against such a top level opponent, when you look at the world stage, I think just that game in general, I thought was very good, not only with the way I played, but I think for my development in the long run as well, and being able to test myself. Mm-hmm. And then Madison against Chattanooga at home, I think I had a nice save coming down the stretch when it was 1-1 to keep us in the game and to try and give us a boost to get 3 points, but and then we'll hold on to the 1 point.
Absolutely, and still many more times for many more memories, still early on in your career, but also with a couple of games remaining for both clubs in the season. So, Dane, I appreciate the time, sir. Thank you for stopping by the program, and we look forward to following your career as you continue to grow and make more memories for both Minnesota and Madison. So thank you for the time.
Thank you again for having me.
Time now for the Loon Report, your weekly look inside forward Madison partner club, Minnesota United. It was a massacre down in Texas. Not in a bad way. 8 goals scored. It was a massacre if you were a goalkeeper on the night. My goodness. 8 total goals scored. 5 for FC Dallas. 3 for Minnesota United. The game got started in the 11th minute with Ethan Finley. He ends the night with a pair. And then FC Dallas, an unlikely hero, Brandon Cervenia, gets a pair as well, among many other goals mixed in. The goalkeeping was skeptical and very spotty in this match. The defenses were kind of non-existent at times. However, there were several amazing plays off the line by both teams, but it ultimately is FC Dallas that claims a very important 3 points as they continue to climb back into playoff contention in the Western Conference. This was a game that was down at FC Dallas in the beautiful state of Texas. Looking at the standings, Minnesota United is in third place now with 38 points, 1 point behind second place team Seattle Sounders. FC Dallas now finds themselves in seventh place, back in playoff contention with a much needed win. Looking ahead for the Loons, what's in store for them? Well, they have a game coming up on August 14th against the Colorado Rapids. That should be another big opportunity to claim some more points. Colorado, the second-to-worst team in the Western Conference right now with only 26 points. The Loons will be chomping at the bit to get after a very impaired and very loose team that needs to allow the Loons to jump a little bit higher up the table once again with 3 more points. And yes, of course, I'm going to comment on Mason Toy's red card. Unfortunately, he released a statement. If you haven't seen it, go and look at it. It's on Instagram. He talks about how he accidentally, he was not intending, at least in his words, to spit on a player. He said, unfortunately, it happened that way where it did, and he regrets his decision, and he is very sorry for that. I believe at the moment he is serving a 1-game ban pending any other information from the team or from the league. So a red card for Mason Toy. Untimely, unfortunate to say the least, but that is what it is in the game of soccer. Keep your spit in your mouth and just wait till you get off the field or walk completely away from the team around you if you need to spit. But is what it is. Minnesota, they fall for the first time in a long time as they go 5-3 to FC Dallas. Plus, they got that 2-1 victory over the Portland Timbers as they head to the U.S. Open Cup final to take on Atlanta United. That's with this week's edition of the Loon Report. Your weekly look inside Forward Madison Partner Club, Minnesota United. Recapping the game that was, Forward Madison taking on the Richmond Kickers, resulting in a 1-0 loss for Forward Madison. I'm not going to say that I am 100%. I don't know how I feel about this. You know what? I was very surprised. I was at a wedding Saturday night, so I was not at a chance to watch the game, but I was trying to keep up with the score, and then I tuned out, obviously, while I was dancing the night away with spending time with my wife and family and friends, and I go back and I check the final score that they lost 1-0. And I was puzzled because this seemed like a very unlikely opponent to lose to. However, Richmond was on a 2-game win streak, so they had a lot going for them when it came to the fact that they were looking to make some big moves. And sure enough, they go on the road and they get a big victory. Forward Madison didn't really look like they were on the offensive foot, at least from the highlights and from some of the conversation I've seen from folks. This was a game where the offense struggled and the defense was exposed a lot, unfortunately. And Richmond really could have made this a 2 or 3-0 game. I know J.C. Banks' free kick almost went in. Just missed the corner post from what all replays can show. If you were there live, I'd love to know what it actually looked like because the video highlights were crap and it looked like the ball went in the net. But from what I'm being told and what's being reported by the league, that's not the case. So if you have more information, fill me in, please. But you look at the starting lineup, this is continuously going to be a big lineup, and I think some people may or may not have questioned, and if you were at the game or watched the game, I'd love to hear your feedback about seeing Toyama as one of the two center backs, because you had Diaz, Toyama, Tobin, and Russell on the back line. Dayne Sinclair also on the goalkeeping regime once again. Then you had Leonard, Banks, Nunez, White, Smart, and Paolo Jr. as your starters. And then you see Bennett, Tenorio, and Bimet come into the game. So three subs compared to who was available. Yeah, I think that makes probably the most sense. But then the substitute for Richmond, he comes on 3 minutes later and gets a goal. It is what it is. That's the thing. That's all you can really say when you're in this position. You say, you know what? It's a loss. 4,500 people still came out, got their bowling shirts, had a roaring good time. And it's a very rare loss at home for Forward Madison. 8 games remaining in the season. Greenville is next. Forward Madison hits the road as they take on Greenville Saturday at 6 p.m. Greenville is the hot ticket right now in USL League One, in my opinion. They keep winning. They keep beating quality opponents. And they keep climbing and climbing and climbing as they continue to keep racking up goals and points in the standings. They have now moved into 5th place, 29 total points overall. This is a great opportunity if Ford Madison can go out and get a victory against Greenville. Greenville has won 4 of their last 5 games. Who does that reflect? Who have they beaten? Well, thank you for asking. They beat Toronto 3-1 this last week. They beat Tormenta 1-0. They beat North Texas 4-0. Then they lost to FC Tucson 3-1, and then they beat Orlando 1-0. That Tucson loss is really surprising. It doesn't really fit with the match of whoever else they've beaten. But you look at the games, they have scored a grand total of a lot of goals and not a lot of time. No, 3 goals in the last game, 1 against Tormenta, 4 against Greenville. Quick math in my head says 8 goals in 3 games, 9 goals in 4 games, 10 goals in the last 5 games. Not bad, if you ask me. So Greenville is going to be really dangerous, and I feel bad saying this, but the fact that Greenville is on a big run right now believes me to feel that Greenville is going to win this game. I think Greenville gets the job done at home against Ford Madison. I expect a 3-1 victory in favor of Greenville because right now Ford Madison offensively slowing down just a little bit. The defense has been a smidge spotty these last 2 games. I would love to see a great win on the road, especially to kind of stick it to Greenville towards the end with some big games coming up at home. However, Greenville gets my vote in this game to win 3-1 in favor of the home team. That's my prediction. I'd love to hear it if you have some thoughts over on Twitter at Baxter Colburn at Let Me Be Forward. This week on Twitter, we asked our question of the week, and we said a very, I feel like, timely question, especially coming off of the 1-0 loss to Richmond. We asked the question, we said, on a scale of 1 to 10, what is your level of confidence Ford Madison will make the playoffs following the 1-0 loss to Richmond? And the response was about what we kind of thought it was going to be. A couple of people actually surprised me with their responses, and I wanted to read a couple of them to you. Michael said 7 out of 10, but if we get a result against Greenville next match, that would jump to an 8 or 9. Mike also, there's another guy, Mike says 6. We still have Greenville twice, Tormenta, North Texas, and Lansing left, so we're on a knife's edge. Stealing 3 points at Greenville will be a boost. I completely agree. Jason said 7. The Lunacy Podcast said 7.15. Joseph, he's all in. He said, I've got 10 on it. Up the flocking goes. Let's see. Another good one was Medicare for some. He said 10 without a doubt. Soft slate of matches upcoming with most of the teams in playoff position playing each other. Let them slug it out while the Mingos keep rising. I agree with that. That's actually a really great opportunity, especially these next couple games, because it does really line up nicely for Ford Madison to hopefully take care of business and secure a good playoff spot before they have to do battle with some of those other teams, like mentioned, like Lansing, North Texas, Tormenta as well. Kyle also said 10. A win puts them right back in the playoff complete contention. Plenty of games left in the season. Completely agree with you on that one. Forward Madison France says 10 always. Flamingo Esther, our friend of the show, says it was a hard-fought game. I'm going to say 8. They're going to be playing their hearts out, and they'll want and they don't want to disappoint their fans even less than they want to disappoint themselves. I agree, and I think that's one big part about all this, and we've heard that many times throughout the season, that this team wants to fight and play hard for the fans. It's not always about the team, it's about the fans. This last one that I want to read is a great thought. This one's from Keith. He says, 6. I worry about our older defensive spine getting burned by counterattacks in a young, speedy league, similar to what happened against Richmond. We play an attractive brand of attacking soccer, but if the final third quality isn't there, we'll lose 1-0 games. Hope I'm wrong. I agree with you on that one, Keith. I think that's a great point, something that I think not many have talked about. I think that was maybe one spot that we saw why Hiro Toyama played at the center back position in this last match against Richmond, was to add a little bit of young flair, a little bit of young speed to the team. But if you haven't answered our question of the week, you can certainly do so at Let Me Be Forward on Twitter is the best way to do. We're going to wrap things up after a fun-filled episode this week. A big thank you to Zaire Bartley, to Dayne Sinclair, to Omar Palacios from Labada 608, and, of course, to Daryl Shore. And my trusty sidekick in all of this is Madeline Kumm, and she did a great job, as always. You can find her on Twitter at Maddie Kumm, M-A-D-D-I-E-K-U-M-M. You can find me on Twitter at Baxter Colburn. That is with a B-A-X-T-E-R, not a B-A-C-K-S-T-E-R like some people like to search for. The show is on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, publichousemedia.org. Wherever you look, you can find us, subscribe for free, and listen to any episode that you want. We'll be back with our final episode in show history next week, August 21st. It is the final episode of Let Me Be Forward during the 2019 year. We'll see if we're back in 2020. Who knows? But for now, we are signing off for the second to last time. I'm Baxter Colburn saying thank you for listening, and I'll see you again next week.